If the rocket blows up, we're all dead. I think that's a fine tagline and kind of motto that we can use for this entire conference. I've printed out some remarks here in what what turns out to be three-point Helvetica, so I'm going to wear my glasses so that I can see what I wrote. So a year ago, I attended a conference called Future Tense in D.C. that was apparently sponsored or something, at least in part by Google. It was at the Google D.C. offices. I used it as a pretext to complain about our society's inability to execute on big stuff, to get big stuff done. In the first two-thirds of the 20th century, we went from not believing that heavier-than-air flight was possible to walking on the moon. So if you took a person off the street in 1900 and put them in a time machine and sent them forward to 1968 and let them look around and then sent them home again to tell the story of what they'd seen, they wouldn't even really have the conceptual or the verbal vocabulary to say what they had seen. You can't talk about nuclear power until you've explained the fact that atoms have nuclei. You can't talk about the conversion of matter into energy without talking about relativity and quantum mechanics. So on the other hand, if you were to take a person from off the street in the year 1968 and send them forward to our time and do the same experiment, the results would be very different. They would say, well, the cars look different. You know, they look at least as different from our cars as our cars look from like 1940s cars. Everyone's got these things that are sort of like a cross between Captain Kirk's communicator and Dick Tracy's wristwatch. You know, and there's some other stuff that's cool. There's this internet thing. You know, typewriters have been replaced by these TV devices. If you look up in the sky, you see 737s and 747s flying overhead just like we have, except in some ways they've gone backwards because they don't have SSTs. There's no sign that they're going to get them back anytime soon. Human space travel is a lost art. We 1968 people can send people to the moon and bring them back. They can't send humans into low Earth orbit. They have to hitch rides off of the Russians. Diseases that we can easily treat with antibiotics have become intractable and are making a comeback. And even diseases that can easily be snuffed out by vaccines are coming back simply because parents aren't getting their kids vaccinated because they don't believe in science anymore. So to be fair, I think that there's a partial explanation for all of this in the rise of the personal computer and the internet, which has siphoned off a huge fraction of our inventive energies to work on forms of progress that aren't as obvious as space rockets and nuclear bombs. I saw the best minds of my generation writing spam filters. But if you look at where we went from 1900 to 1968 and where we've been from then to now, it seems as though at about that time, I won't pick a specific year, but somewhere around then, we kind of slammed into a brick wall as far as sort of big innovations in what our physical built environment looks like. I think that this is partly due to a kind of allergic reaction that we had simply to the sheer amount of change that had occurred, and in particular to the some of the environmental side effects that had been kind of blithely ignored up to that point. So I get that. I was certainly raised to be an environmentalist, and all of my knee-jerk reactions are kind of in tune with those of the environmental movement. But Deepwater Horizon and Fukushima kind of converted me to the view that the threat now has become not too much innovation, but not enough innovation. The reactors that melted down at Fukushima were built in the early 1970s based on designs from the 1960s. So if you look under the hood of a 1960s automobile, if you can even find one that's still running, and you compare it to what you see under the hood of a modern vehicle, it has to send a little chill down your spine to think that nuclear reactors built in that or designed in that same era are still hot today. It's not my purpose to single out the environmental movement, but that does embody a certain mentality about risk that has become so tied up in intellectual knots that it has the net long-term effect of making things more risky. It's my thesis that a small number of people have to be willing to shoulder greater risks in order to create changes that eventually reduce risk for civilization as a whole. And that when they stop fulfilling that responsibility, a decline sets in that may require some conscious effort to reverse. It shows up most conspicuously in public attitudes towards science and technology. American culture from the very beginning has had a very powerful anti-elite, anti-intellectual strain. It's been well covered in books like Anti-Intellectualism in American Life by Hofstadter, and a more recent book called Susan Jacoby. But it's it's about sort of the decline of American rationalism. Came out a couple of years ago. Anyway, it's people who espouse that kind of mentality are markedly aggressive, and they are relentless. They never stop working to further their goals, to the extent that they tolerate progress at all, it's on a what have you done for me lately sort of basis. So through the first part of the 20th century, we were able to keep them off balance with spectacular advances that couldn't really be argued with. Here's an airplane, argue with that. I just saved your kid's life with penicillin, argue with that. Here's a mushroom cloud, polio vaccine, a guy walking around on the moon. Argue with those. But when those inarguable triumphs stop coming, the anti-science people come back and begin making inroads to a degree that educated people can't even comprehend. For example, by denying that the moon landings ever happened. So it's entirely plausible that 100 years from now, it may be believed by 99% of all the people in the world that the moon landings were a hoax. And the idea that they actually happened may have the status of a totally marginalized conspiracy theory. That is a totally achievable result. And there are people who are actively working to make that kind of thing happen. There's an old saying that when you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So my hammer happens to be the ability to write science fiction, and so I've been looking for ways to use it to hammer down this troublesome nail that I've just been describing. One of the ideas that emerged from that future tense conference a year ago was that of producing some new science fiction stories that were aimed at describing future alternative societies in which big things had gotten done, which is a thing that science fiction hasn't been doing for a while. I mean, this is all fine, but science fiction has, during about the same time that we've kind of stopped innovating on a big scale, at least in the physical world. Science fiction has become sort of inward-looking, kind of postmodern, introspective, focused more on social stuff. It's a good and healthy thing to have done, in the current climate, it seems like kind of a strange and radical innovative idea to sort of write science fiction that's a throwback to the golden age of science fiction stuff, the kind of techno-optimistic stuff that I used to read when I was a kid. The unifying principle of what I'd like to see written for this project is that it should talk about innovations such that a young person just starting their career today could read one of these stories and say, this doesn't exist now, but if I start working on it today, by the time I retire, it might exist. So Michael Crow, who's out there somewhere, there's Michael, who's the president of Arizona State University, was at the same conference and made the mistake of falling in with me, or perhaps vice versa. He has been busy launching a new entity there called the Center for Science and the Imagination, which will be a kind of sibling to this science fiction writing project. The name of the science fiction project is Hieroglyph, and the purpose of this kind of two-headed beast is going to be to foster direct collaboration between science fiction writers on the one hand and researchers, engineers, scientists, and students on the other. I'm going to have to ask you to read all of this on sort of two levels at once from here on out. I'm going to be talking about one specific idea, which you may find fascinating or you may think is incredibly stupid. At the same time, you need to be thinking about it on a kind of meta level as one exemplar of a kind of idea or a category of thinking that could take other forms. In other words, this isn't about me or any one particular idea that I might espouse, but the idea I'm interested in is, in a sense, a very old idea, dating at least back to Babylon. It's the idea of making an incredibly tall building. What does really tall mean? It's an interestingly loaded question all by itself. The default answer for the last century or so has tended to be a little bit taller than the tallest building today. So building heights have crept rather than leapt upwards, since success is defined merely in terms of breaking the current record. But that's more a reflection of our impoverished ambitions than of physics. As the physicist and science fiction writer Jeff Landis pointed out in a couple of papers published about 10 years ago, there's no reason in principle why a tower couldn't be constructed out of plain old steel to a height of 15 or 20 kilometers. That's about 20 times the height of the Burj Dubai, the tallest building in the world today. Not surprisingly, if you use high-tech materials like carbon fiber, you can go much higher, but 20 kilometers is not bad. According to Landis's calculations, a conventional rocket launched from the top of such a tower would have double the payload to orbit of a similar rocket launched from sea level. And given the cost of launching anything whatsoever into orbit, that starts to add up to kind of an interesting economic argument pretty quickly. Those of you who've studied the physics of space launch may want to talk about these numbers. I certainly would if I were you. And I personally would like nothing more than to geek out about the space and physics aspects of this all night long. I'm happy to do that later. But if we... If all we're talking about is space launch, the real promise of building an incredibly tall building lies not simply in launching sort of conventional rockets off the top of it, but in using it to support other more innovative types of launchers. Beyond that, such a structure could have many other uses, some of which I can imagine and some of which I can't. And so part of what I'd eventually like to do, this will come as a surprise, hopefully a pleasant surprise to Peter, is to sort of design the tower in the abstract and then throw the question out to the general public. Okay, if this tower existed, what can you think of to do with it? You know, what are some, you know, there's an X Prize. You know, here's a 20-kilometer tower. What can you build on it? With the help of Michael, I made contact with Dr. Keith Helmstad, who's an engineering professor at Arizona State, whose resume happens to be perfect for this. I mean, it's kind of weird if I asked a genie to produce the perfect guy to think about this problem. Keith would step out of the swirling cloud of purple mist. So Keith has been working this problem pretty hard on a much more sophisticated level than I'm capable of, and taking into account things like wind loading. So this tower would, you'd have to assume that this tower would get hit by the jet stream occasionally, and the jet stream is an awesome force of nature. Even if you allow for that, Keith's conclusion so far is that even under those extreme conditions, making a 15-kilometer high tower out of steel is probably doable. No fundamentally new technology is required. And that's an important detail. This is a pilot project. It's the first in what we hope will be a stream of ideas that will germinate in the heads of SF writers and make their way into some kind of development. As such, it could kind of set a pattern. And I sort of like the idea of having our first project be one that is clearly technologically possible, because that shifts the burden away from the engineers and onto the shoulders of the society in which they're embedded. If you remove the "it's just not possible" excuse, then it raises the question of why aren't we doing it then? Which is what's interesting to me and apparently a lot of other people. There's a lot of technologically feasible things that we're failing to do, such as becoming energy independent. What is going on in the financial and management worlds that has caused us to narrow our scope and reduce our ambitions so drastically? I don't claim to know the answer, but I think it's a good question. And I'm hoping that during the course of the next couple of days, we might make some progress towards answering it. Thank you.